Hello everyone, Kyubashi here, and it's gonna be a replay analysis on Monkey King. Right there, that's him. So yeah, this is gonna be a replay analysis on Monkey King. This is a game I literally just played. My voice is kind of messed up because I sort of did not yell, but I was a commanding force behind our team, and I had to raise my voice because the Void really wouldn't listen to my instructions. Alas, we ended up winning, and I just had to play around him. But regardless, let's focus on my Monkey King for now. This is a 5.1k average game. I'm 5.6 in this game. I literally just got it from winning this game. But a 5.1k average with the death profit being 5.8. So on average, her team is like lower than her, and mine is a bit higher. But it averages out at 25-25. So as you can see here, I go for a poor man shield on a Zango. It's a typical me build. I do this because poor man shield as a whole, it makes Monkey King very tanky, makes it really easy to go Jingo off, to get Jingo off. And gives him the ability, of course, to like extra damage, extra attack speed, extra armor. It's great. It's kind of aggressive, but I mean, it's worked for me and it's never really failed me, this kind of build. One thing that's worth noting is that I actually fail skill in this game. Normally I max Jingo first, but for some reason I think I was tired. This is like 5, 6 a.m. in the morning, so this is like 6, 7 a.m. I'm making this video. Not sure why I would do it now, but it just felt appropriate after the game. I'm kind of like high on an adrenaline rush right now. But I actually max Boundless Dragon, that's kind of a mistake. Anyway, I basically ask the Undying to come with me. He's kind of slow out. Normally I like to get up here quicker. But I want to like contest this rune, because you might as well with Monkey King, and especially Undying. These are two really freaking good early fighters. And as you can tell, I want him to go first, and I instruct him as much. But we're going to be fast forwarding a bit here and there. So we were just going to come down and poke his head. Yeah, we can see him. We're like, yeah, you just come at us, bro. And he basically revealed he had the K there, which is not a surprise. So we'll end up getting three runes, because Undying's gonna go down and get this, so that's good. They, for some reason, were all here, which is just kind of weird. But yeah, I'll be dual laning with Undying. And I'm mainly gonna be talking through the laning stage, and then skip forward, because there's a lot of farming, and then focus on pretty much each team fight and how I perform in them and like how I play. So if you've seen my Monkey King before, it's pretty much what I like to call hyper aggressive. I try to go in as much as humanly possible, really. Like, look at this. My first move is just to see if I can get him, because if I can get Jingo Strikes off, it's just, you know, it adds so much sustain. So Disruptor's entire early game is literally going to be nothing but just slamming me up with his bolts a lot. He will do that a lot. So I'm going to fast forward a bit here, because it's pretty boring laning phase until we actually get Jingo off. And see, just staying calm, playing around and dying. Going to get an Oba Venom so I can take rush down. At this point, I probably am telling Undying, okay, wait for level 2 or 3 before we go, because at level 3, I have 1-1-1, and at level 2, I have both Jingo and Tree Dance. But with the added Boundless Strike, that just means you can get free kills. So this is pretty good. You can see, as I said, he's just sitting with mana pot, which is super typical. So yeah, go on him here. And again, I'm going to get Jingo off here. And you can see, I can just rush him down. Easy, easy. And this is actually without a zombie even proccing on him. He's still going to die because Monkey King is Monkey King, and the Monkey King is fairly balanced. So that's the first blood. Now, Weaver wants to kill me, which he's not going to because Lifesteal is a bit too strong. And there you pretty much have it. He could have like tried to go back on us and apply a pod, but he decided against it, which is smart. There was a tombstone there. Albeit it died now, so I'm okay. And I tell Undying I'm gonna go for a sanctuary, I remember, and he doesn't want to come, which is fine. I just wanted to, like, you know, skip going all the way back. So that's already first blood to my advantage, which is super common when I play on Monkey King. I'd say in general it's super common if there's a Monkey King in the game. Should pause quickly. By the way, I just want to reference, this is, I don't like calling the patch 701, but that is what official Valve people call it. But this is the post-nerf Monkey King. That's worth noting. It's the post-nerf Monkey King. That's not why I'm maxing Boundless Strike. That was literally just an error. I would still not do that. That's also why I do less damage. And I was like, 5 or 6 minutes into a game, I was like, wow, I do a lot less damage. I know what I mean? Like, I've even played him like post-nerf too, but this just felt weird. And sure enough, I was miskilling. You see, I really like getting 3 Jingo Strikes off, because it makes people really afraid. And they know if I get it off, I'm going to go in and try and kill them. But we win this lane really significantly, and I mean, spoiler alert, we win the game, but still. But this is mainly a video, like, just to show you how to play Monkey King slash how I play Monkey King, and just an analysis of it. If you like how he plays and how I play him, I pretty much always take him off lane, either solo or duel. I normally don't request a duel, but I actually think dual off lane Monkey King is like the best. He actually reminds me a lot of like what I used to do with Arc Warden when he was actually still viable. You could say he still is, but that's another story. That's another story, another time, really. He's gonna take this. Very good, Undying. Good play. Viper kills mid. It's good. Let's speed through a bit. Don't want to like make this video far too long. It's probably gonna like be up towards half an hour though. See, I go in here. And this, at this moment, I sort of semi-regret a bit, but we do get Boundless Strike off. And I could have potentially chased there. I decided against it, and the only reason really was because of Weaver's Beetle. And also because I don't want to exchange my death for a Disruptor. I don't, because why would we be winning this lane? I'd rather just pull back, because I know I can just like keep him out. He has no HP or regeneration anymore, so that's totally cool with me. You can see how I wait here in the trees. So I'm doing a lot of poking in this game, like forcing them out of my lane. Also, they lose bottom really, really big time. They're also like dual lane, and Crystal Maiden isn't that good against dual lanes when she's a solo support, but whatever. Again, we're going to focus on the Monkey King. So I'm going to go back. I'm going to go fetch a rune here. I should actually have gone directly here, so that's a bit of a misplay, which is going to give me upgraded boots and then a port. So we're going to speed through here. And I'm just going home. And no, I do not have the Arcana, so... I'm currently sitting at about 85% win rate on this hero at like 19 games, I think. I'll show you after the game is done. You can see my Monkey King score. So that's it. He wins me a lot of MR, even after the nerf. I still think he's mad broken. Whether or not you agree or disagree, totally fine. That is a subjective opinion. But when I see how well I can perform with him, and when I see how hard he can be to beat when I'm against him, I just can't see how you can like not think he's like insane. he simply does too much with too little. Let's see, I'm gonna like follow Disruptor here. He's probably gonna glimpse if memory serves. Yeah, that's fine. Glimpses me back into Weaver. But that's fine, then he's used it, and that means I'll have more time to go in. And I really wanted to jump in on him here. The problem, of course, being that Boundless Strike was sort of nerfed, else I might have even done it. It was nerfed, if you don't know, like the damage is now a lot less, yeah, about 60% less at level 1 at least. And this is a little bit too aggressive for me, but we can technically Tombstone. And there we go, we're gonna get a kill here. And I'm gonna let the zombie finish him off. Sadly, he gets Tombstone, which is worth quite a bit, 150. So that's 150 for 285 exchange, still worth it for us, but still. But yeah, look at how what do you call it, like, vivid I am on lane. I'm just all over the place when I play Monkey King. I like putting my my opponents on their toes. So we're gonna go back. And it's kind of like the late game that's gonna be crazy, like the mid-late game. Because the problem I had with this game was that people wouldn't listen to me a lot, but then they realized, holy shit, maybe this guy is actually, he knows what he's talking about. And then everyone except Void started to play around me better. But up until that point, everyone was kind of like playing their own game. You'll see what I mean. Also, I'm porting down here, which is also typical. I simply port down there and tell them before I come that I'm going to gank. And sure enough, it just gives you an easy gank. He even gets me Jingle off by doing that, which is actually technically a misplay. If you want to get super technical about it, he just gives me Jingle for free by doing that. So that is literally worse. Because it means he heals me, or I can save one Jingle charge. Not sure if I'm doing that here. Yeah. So this is a typical thing I do too. I'm not sure if I'm saving it entirely. I actually am. I now remember what I was doing. Right. So my assumption was, all right, I'm going to stay here and wait. Because now I have Jingle, right? Oh, they saw me jump in here, by the way. I didn't know this at the time, of course. I can see that in the replay now. Which makes sense. He was like really scared not coming online. Anyway, if you don't know, you can save Jingle indefinitely. They nerfed it just now from 15 to 20, to 10, 20? 10? What the hell did I say? They nerfed it from 15 to 10 seconds. So like you can strike and then you have 10 seconds to get another strike in. Before it was 15, but the Jingle Mastery still lasts forever. So what you can technically do is that you can at least save one or more charges. So you can save up towards 4 if you want. And you can save them for a good Boundless Strike, which can literally, like, if I hadn't waited here, I could have ported up here, sought out this Raptor, and literally done one Boundless Strike, and I guarantee you, half health. He would die instantly with like a combination force of me and on Undying, I guarantee you. And I don't know Elsie's here, of course. She can freeze her. She does that there, but does it too late. Which is sad, because she saw her way in advance. And this kind of like puts me in a panic, because I want to save her. And that's obviously a misplay. But then he comes in. I strike way too quickly there, for that matter. That's actually sort of like a semi misplay, and she gets very lucky with her lifesteal too. And I'll end up dying here. So this is one of the first deaths, but I Bono stuck way too quickly there. And this is like, this is when I realized, I looked at my skill and I was like, wait a fucking moment. I'm level 5 and I skilled 3 in Bono Strike? That's just weird, because I will always go 1-1-1, and then 3 in Jingo Mastery, and then Ultimate, of course. Well, actually, I don't always do Ultimate, but like, Ultimate is pretty fucking insane. But it gets progressively better. But I max Jingo, then I go Boundless, and then I wait for Tree Dance last. Because I actually don't think maxing Tree Dance is a good thing. You don't really need it for him to like be what he is. I see most people max Jingo and then Tree Dance and then Boundless Strike, and I always say, why? Most people, they say, well, you don't need to max Boundless Strike. This was back before the nerf, by the way. Their argument was, you don't need to max Boundless Strike because it only increases the stun time. And I'm like, 0.5 seconds to 2 seconds is insane. It means I can literally gank anywhere from the trees and I can do a range 2 second stun, guaranteed, if I hit it, of course. But like, it's pretty much a guaranteed hit if I'm not completely dumb. And now after the nerf, you kind of need to just to get the crit multiplier going. So now, I would argue that like, even if you were in favor of the other build before, mine is just unarguably better now. Because you kind of need this. And you don't really need Primal Spling slow to be 70%. And the damage is nice, but okay. The way I use Tree Dance plus Primal Spling is that I usually jump to a tree and then I E immediately, and you'll be seeing that a lot this game. I very rarely let it charge completely unless I know I can get it off. Because the problem is, it wouldn't be a problem if the animation didn't show, but it does. And the problem with, like, I'm not saying the animation shouldn't be showing, because that would be horribly broken. Like, you would have almost... Then I would really consider maxing it, because it would just be broken. Like, you would just be able to come in with so much damage for no reason. But because of that, you don't, like, need to do it. Right, I should not pause too much, because I can usually talk over most of the action, and I do want to keep, like, this 30 to 35 minutes. But it's not gonna... There's no way this is gonna take 15 minutes. I always take up towards half an hour. So I see Disruptor, and I really want to go in, and that's kind of like a failed ultimate, sadly. But I didn't have Boundless Strike ready. But that's fine, because like, his ultimate has no freaking cooldown. That's actually one of the things I think they should honestly increase. First of all, like, the ultimate is too strong, still, I think. But it's the cooldown that's just crazy, I think. At level 18, sorry, I was about to say 16, but you know, 6, 12, 18, that's the new levels. At level 18, 70 seconds, that means you can literally use it as an area denial as opposed to, you know, actively killing people. And you'll be seeing that super late game too. I decide to do it up here and here, just to area deny them. And you know what? They go in and try to fight me, you know what happens? They all die, because they can't fucking outlive Wukong's command, because it's too strong. Right, so I'm hiding up here, they can't see me, and I'm intentionally waiting for them to go in on him, because I know they're gonna, and then I do this, of course. And he's dead. And I get this off. Glad he didn't take that, because that would have meant I wouldn't get the thing off. I need to be careful here. You can see she's coming. And he actually saved my life there, because if he hadn't done that, that would have been bad. So the only reason I didn't die there was literally because undying. He really played well this game. I want to actually shout out to him. I'm not sure what his name was, just King. He's a lot of the reason that I'm doing so fairly well on lane, because I kind of over-aggress a lot in this game. And I want to, you know, give respect where respect is due. He really gave me a good early game. He went with my shenanigans. He didn't back down. He was willing to trade his life for mine. And that was smart, because I won him the game, sure. But still, I appreciate when players do that effort, you know. Right, so I'm going to quickly go back here. And I should honestly put this on player perspective instead, I imagine. Nah, it can be a bit confusing. Because, like, I look around a lot when I play Monkey King. So I'm just going to follow the camera here. And that is a tree going absolutely insane. Holy crap. That is some awesome physics. We're just going to let that go. There you go. You can see I go in here. And I want to stun both of them. And there you go. And we ult. And guess what happens next? Like, a good guess. Because, you know, Wukong's command is pretty strong. And yeah, this was like a level... this was a... What level am I even? I can't see because of the thing. Put that down. Level 8 at 10 minutes. And it was easy. I could have taken a third guy too. Because it's impossible to pretty much fight within Wukong's command. And I think this is what really makes Monkey King insanely strong. I don't think he has a down phase. There are some people that are like, oh, he's bad late game, or ooh, he's early game, he's susceptible to ganks and like dying easily. Yes, he is, but he's also slippery as hell. I guess what I'm saying is like, he has a toolkit to play around all bad matchups, I feel. Even if they pick Timber, even if they pick Batrider, I just feel this hero has so much to offer. Also, this rune didn't show on my thing. the first time I went over it. It was really weird. Not sure if that was a visual glitch I was having. So we're gonna keep farming, and I'm gonna move forward here. So the way I basically, you'd normally build this hero is that I go for, and this might confuse you, because I actually don't build him like most people do. I've started to like go a little bit more towards the common thing, but it depends on like how the game goes. So if you know Monkey King by now, the common build right now is simply Echo, Skull Basher, and maybe Deso, but like Echo Skull Basher is like what normal people, like most people go, normal people. It's what most people go on Monkey King, and it's pretty fair, it's good, it's strong, because Skull Basher is broken together with Wukong's command, because you'll see how broken it is in this game too, I'll show it to you. And I hope that, that word doesn't trigger you. Some people are like, oh, it's not broken, but it's like, come on, dude. I mean, if I can win, I don't have another hero I can win this much with, maybe except for another hero that I'm not going to talk about, but that's, you know, But anyway, most people go for Echo, Skull Basher, and then they pretty much win the game normally. I tend to actually go for Echo, and then I actually skip Skull Basher. I get it later because it's still insane, but I normally go S and Y. But I'm not going to do that this game. Normally I go S and Y because the speed is good, the MAME is good, it works with Q, you can follow up like crazy, you're tanky. And I also oftentimes go for Scotty. The only problem with Scotty is like it's kind of cumbersome to build, but that's what it is. What was it I wanted to say? But yeah, in this game I'm going to build a Lincoln Sphere for fairly obvious reasons. I'm actually going to go back here. I'm bad at that. Like, oh shit. So that's Monkey King causing that. So I see her pushing here, and I'm like, okay. By the way, I talk a lot when I play, so a lot of these plays look like it's a party game. It's not. It's literally because I'm just telling them in advance what I plan on doing. I'm like, okay, we need to deal with Death Prophet. I'm going to move in here, and then let's go on her. And I tell Viper that, and she sure enough follows me up. So I see Death Prophet here, and that's going to cool down the moment, you know, I jump there. And I see, like, there's no reason for me not to do that, because I have max Boundless Strike, so that's 2 seconds. And now she knows she's fucked, because I just jumped over her. And I was actually a bit too slow there. She should have just silenced me. She would still have died, but still. I actually was too slow. I should have Boundless Struck immediately. So now we're on a mecha kill streak, and Weaver's just sending out a crap ton of those. Oh, those are bugs. Never mind. Those are literally bugged. Okay. Right. I keep going and see how I save one Jingo again. This is on purpose because I want to like get a Jingo off. And you can tell I want to kill Weaver. It's not going to happen though, of course not. Even though like this is like the regular old like thing. Because I have max Boundless Strike, I'm not as strong as Monkey King used to be. There's literally no downside to me anymore. I see him here and I know Disruptor's going to go. And I wait for Disruptor because of this. Because I'm like, okay. Now he can't glimpse anymore. Because I was rather sure he was going to do that. Because, let's be real, any goddamn Disruptor that supports is going to wait behind this tree when someone's pushing. And I was like, just playing around that. And I told him, just port, dude, it's fine. Because this is going to happen. And I should be going doo-doo-doo in a second. And here we go. Kind of messed it up a bit, but there you go. Half his health. Do my ultimate. I didn't really have to, but there was no need not to do it. Because it means Weaver can't really fight me. And he also even does his ultimate. I could maybe even have gone like in on him there. Yeah, I definitely could have. Oh well. It's fine. I see Void comes in and finishes him off. Kind of lucky. That could actually have messed me up a bit, but it's fine. And this is actually where I die because I did not expect all three of them to come. I could have just gone back. They would have been wasting their time, but I didn't see it happen. They will both die here if memory serves. Let's see. No, they actually managed to turn around. And he even gets a bash here. That's pretty lucky. That was pretty good engagement, everything considered. So, oh man, I can't see how long this has been going for. I imagine it's gone for like at least 15 minutes. I don't have a timer because it makes my computer kind of queasy if I do it while I'm recording. So I'm going to port down here. I'm going to hit Weaver. Not like it matters because, first of all, I'm not going to get Jingo off. I don't have a thing yet. It's not like he's going to man fight me. He ults, but he gives me Jingo off. That's actually a funny thing that Jingo remains on him after he ults. That feels like it shouldn't be a thing, but it is. So it's actually usually incredibly easy to get it off on Weaver if he decides to ult within that time frame. You can see how I go back. This is actually me intentionally trying to trick him to like stay here because I want to fight him. And yeah, he thinks I've gone from the lane probably, but in reality I just did this to make him think I did. That's pretty good, but still. Not quiet. And they go on me here. Too bad I get hit because I kind of want to get the beetle off me. And here I consider saving a Jingo, but I didn't do it. I should honestly have done it just so I could fight. I also tell my team, can we possibly defend? I have Wukong's command, and I believe I go back in. Yeah, I do. Kind of a bad Wukong. I should actually have jumped in first and then Wukong here, but still, it's gonna go just fine. But still, a misplay is a misplay, and I'm willing to respect when I make one. It would have been way better if I jumped first. I guess I was afraid of a silence. There's usually a reason behind the madness. Sometimes I do execution arrows, but there I think, honestly, I was just afraid of silence. Because there is a long wind-up time. Because provided that she actually... Oh, shit. Well, there was a lot of action there. Let me just... I didn't expect that. I forgot all about that. So I pour top because I see I'm dying and I have Jingo. And this is kind of what happens. It's great. So she just jumps in randomly. And she doesn't expect that from me. And here's where the 2-second stun really comes in. So beautiful. Too bad Weaver can do that. I could have tried to follow up, and maybe I even should have, but I decided against it. I did have Jingo ready, but I didn't have a Boundless Strike ready. And that's Monkey King. So we're sitting at 10-5. If we look at the rest of our team, we're doing fairly good by comparison. 0-5-5, 1-2, 10, 3-5-5, and 6-1-3. Viper's doing pretty good right now. But he's just dying mid. Again, my team played alright. When they started listening to me, it went a lot better. I basically asked them to buy smoke so we could gank. We never actually got it. Well, actually, we sort of got it off, but Void didn't want to be part of it. I'm not sure if he was mad with me or if he just didn't want to listen. Some people, even if you try to like win by trying to like, you know, team spirit and stuff, they just won't listen. But I mean, it's worth trying just for the sake that people listen to you. And I think this game is even a testament to that. We had very... Like, it might look like we have decent team, but we really don't. Most of the time, it's literally just me telling them exactly what I plan to do, and they sort of play around it. They would not be playing as well around it if it wasn't for me saying my intentions, I guarantee you. So, I guess what I'm saying is it's pretty important to, like, if you're not unwilling to use a microphone, I can highly suggest it. It's just like CS to me, really. Like, I don't see why you wouldn't, if as long as you're not shy. Or you just want to chill. A lot of people are like, but I play Dota 2 to chill, so I don't want to use a mic. Totally fine. I mean, I can't stop you from that. You should be able to even enjoy ranked however you want. But I'm telling you, if you're willing to use a microphone, I guarantee you can win more. 100% this patch. So I move in here, and I intentionally wait a bit, and I could have waited a little bit longer. But we will still get her, because I'll get this thing off. And then I want to get this guy. So I'm going to chase. But I don't have jump ready, and I have no mana. If memory serves. Oh, I do. So I do go off him, and he's dead. And that's another kill. So we're slitting. Jesus, I mispronounce a lot. 11-7. So I want to get Necro here, because I have Jingo, but like, of course, it's unlikely. Also, he does have Ghost Shroud. I call it Corporeal Form for some reason, but it's basically Ghost Scepter Form. If you don't know, Boundless Strike is a physical attack, which means if he goes into Ghost Form, Ghost Shroud, whatever, Ghost Scepter, I'm gonna call it Ghost Form. If he goes into Ghost Form, I will do no damage to him because it's a physical hit. It's just like Ember, really. Also, by the way, Legion is kind of like wrecking down here, which is really bad. He should actually just have pushed instead, because he would go into the tower. And I was like, guys, can we port? Now, I didn't see back here whether or not anyone had TP. Void, Undying Technique has TP, but I can understand why he's a bit afraid. Why the hell Void doesn't have a TP is beyond me, though. I believe I don't have one, because I used my last one to get up here in the first place. It might be the same for both of these, I don't know. But we didn't have one, which was really bad. You should always have a TP in this meta in particular, because split pushing can be really lethal, definitely. I'm gonna keep going here. Why I didn't take that is beyond me. I must have been looking elsewhere. That's kind of bad. I mean, again, execution errors happen. And they have quite a lot of wards, by the way. So they saw me a lot of the time, and I guess you can kind of see that when I start being sneaky with 3-Dance. Move in here. Gonna take that from CM, even though she really wanted it. And Viper dies, and that kind of is the problem with the game. Viper and Void end up dying a lot randomly, just out of nowhere. So this is scary because she has invisibility and stuff now, and she really wants to gank me. So I go mid, and I don't know, I can't remember, I sensed something was wrong the way my allies were playing. It was like the way I saw this guy, and the way he moved was just artificial as hell. And I was like, there's something wrong. There's no way he would move this way if he was solo. If he was solo, he would not even dare to be remotely close to me. He's already seen what I'm capable of, so it makes no sense. So I basically decide, okay, this is just too fucking scary. So I just immediately get the hell out of there, because I can immediately sense something is just wrong. Like, no one plays like this. it's just dumb. No human would in their right mind go against Monkey King like this if you didn't plan on killing him, so I just decide to bail it. And you can see she really wants to kill me. Understandably so, I'm worth a lot. And I want to go here, and I can see, okay, they saw me. So that moment right there, because like this is an important moment in the game, Weaver actually was the one that made me react the way I did. If he hadn't done Swarm, she would have killed me, I guarantee you. It was Weaver that made it so I didn't die. And I'll even put it in slow motion so you can tell, because I immediately was like, that's just weird. Because, okay, so he knows I'm here now, I know he's here, but I don't know he has a ward there. But I see him turn towards me and do Swarm, and I'm like, okay, that's fucking weird, he didn't see me. So I know something's up. So I'm immediately just gonna bail on that. And what a good choice, because see what happens here. That was very fucking close, and I'm like, okay, I need to get the fuck out of there. And I do. And I might ulti, I think I do. Knowing me. Or am I just gonna keep running? I ult. Because I'm like, okay, sure, if they wanna fight me, then fight me in my ultimate. And I activate this, because that means I have like unlimited regeneration. So now they have two options, get the fuck out or try to fight me. Either way, they're not gonna kill me. It's just not happening. And this is what I mean, like this is a perfect example of using my ultimate. Not as, like it was aggressive, but it was more of like a come at me bro kind of play, right? It was more of like an area denial. It was like, okay, if they're willing to fight me, go for it. Sadly, two of my players are randomly dying across the map while all this is happening, which is sad because like two of their strongest heroes are in here, which made me kind of peeved a bit. I was busy kiting them. And remember, as long as you just stay within here, the entire ultimate just remains there. And I'm fairly certain these guys want to go back in on me. I mean, they've already proven they really want to kill me. So I stay in the trees right here because it means that, again, the ultimate will keep up. And I'm just looking for them because I'm pretty sure they want to go back in. See Void going in here. And maybe I shouldn't have hit here, but I wanted to get Jingo off. And I go for Weaver because I can, because I know zombies are going to kill there. So that's pretty much why. So we exchange Void for two kills there. So that was quite fine, because Void ended up being kind of like, eh, he was expendable to say the least in this game. Also, at this point, of course, I have Echo. You can see the ultimate orb, obviously going to be part of the Lincoln Sphere I was talking about. So I should really speed things up, because this is already lasting a lot. And I'm explaining a lot of the same things of how I do, but I hope it's useful to you. Again, I can highly suggest playing Monkey King. He's probably the most fun champion. He's probably the most fun hero I've played in Dota for like 2 years. Last time I had this much fun with it with a hero was when Terrorblade was really broken, I think. And that's been a long ago since it was like that. Back in the good old days. So we're gonna be moving a bit forward until I can see what's happening. And at this point I'm like, okay guys, we need to catch them. But you can see, like, look at how good their warding is. If there's one thing for sure, we had kind of really poor warding compared to them. Their warding was just 10 times better than ours. They had wards everywhere. We had very defensive wards, they had very aggressive wards, which was, like, that's the way they should plan them too, because their plan was to, like, catch me and kill me, which makes sense, you know. If they kill me, they would win the game. They would, without a doubt. If I had died more often. That's also why I play semi-defensive. Like, normally I will be way more aggressive around the map, but with LC being there, and with them having so much vision, I don't really feel safe at all. On top of that, whenever I feel like I might not be able to trust my teammates as much, I tend to play a lot more defensive, because comeback gold isn't what it used to be, but still, I don't want to randomly die for no reason, other than my own greed. So, like, I'm gonna, you know, let probably Catapult go here, yeah. Because, again, I suspect there might be an LC here, and under the circumstances there might be, I'm gonna leave it. A lot of my plays are going to be like that. It's going to, like, you know, really pussy out, as I normally say on my stream. You know, see here, we're building towards Lincoln. Weaver has it now. Going to be speeding up a bit. And just farm here. But yeah, game goes good. It was fun, but it was very, very hard. It was a very, very hard game for me to win. But it felt stimulating because it was one of those games where I felt I was the sole reason we won that. Also the fact that, like, Undying gave me a good game. But, like, you know those games where you either feel like your performance as a player or leadership won you the game? This was a matter of both for me, I feel. It was the fact that I was constantly communicating with everyone, and the fact that I was also playing really well on top of it. I made mistakes, yeah, but if you look by my score, I pretty much have pretty much as many kills and assists as anyone. So my contribution to this team is, like, insane. And it's no, I'd say it's no, what do you call it, not coincidence, it's no hidden secret that if Void had been like decent slash really good, this game would have been over like within 25 or 30 minutes for sure. The only reason it lasts so long is because my other cores keep dying a lot. And it ends up being Wukong Command that really wins the game, fair and square. They basically fight into my ultimate twice and it just erupts them because I just have so much farm. And there comes a play that I'm going to be really upset about where Void basically bails on me. In all fairness, he doesn't have his ultimate when it happens, but I told him I was going to do it and I expected follow-up and he didn't go for it. And he basically sacks me, which is terrible. So I go on her here. A little bit scared of her because Elsie is kind of scary. He does an ultimate, which is kind of pointless, but whatever. If they had been there, they could have fucked us all up, so that was very inconsiderate. I mean, the thing is, like, it depends. If she had gotten lucky, she would have killed CM, and of course, yeah. It can be both a misplay and a play. It was just a good thing their team wasn't there, because I could have died because of it. Viper dying again. At this point, Viper's 8-4-3, and my Void is 2-3-14. He's actually not doing as bad as I thought, but he's getting a lot of assists. He's going the Shadow build, which is ever so common, really. At this point, I have Lincoln Sphere, as you can tell. I do not have buyback right now. So I go in here. I go in here. And I can tell they want to go on my tower, obviously. And I really want to, like, you know, go on them. So I see her going here. And I kind of assumed that because she went forward, she was going to go for me. And that was, again, a bad ultimate. I should have jumped and done my ultimate. It was just a bad ultimate. If I had jumped and done my ultimate, chances are we would have won that fight easily. Like, from the get-go, without my team even having to do anything. So I'm gonna keep it a bit low down here, and see Crystal's doing her ultimate. Ultimate is still running on Death Prophet, but she's almost dead. And there she goes. I deny the tower because it was, like, pretty low. And I try to follow up. But we could have had 3 kills here, if I had played normally, for sure. That's kinda sad. So follow up on the Disruptor here, just to give him vision, and we kill him. Again, it's almost impossible to run from Monkey King. So this is a decision where I just decide to leave, because I have Boundless Strike, and I can't remember if I do it. I think I might probably do it right here. Huh, I keep going, that's kinda weird. I think I'm afraid of doing this, honestly. I also realize, okay, yeah, I realize how little damage that did to Necro. So I'm like, okay, I have to bail out here, because if I die, it's really, really bad. I should honestly have Boundless Struck earlier, but it was not going to change a whole lot. Again, like, look at that. I'm going to show you that one more time. Wow, I sound like a salesman. I'm going to show that to you one more time, ladies and gentlemen. But look at this. This is how I use tree most of the time. Instead of charging it up, I use it for, like, just, you know, quickly getting in and out. So jump, and then E immediately, and just press E again to, like, release it. See how quickly that goes. Because you cover so much distance. I always say that, you know, Monkey King essentially has like a free bling dagger distance. If you do W and E. And that's pretty strong. It's really good for follow-up and it's really good for getting out. It's also why I left, I came away from Elsie so quickly when she was close to killing me before. So I've died 2 times. I'll die 1 more in this game, and that's when Void kind of fails me. And it almost loses us the game because no one has buyback. And I don't have it because I assumed he was going to help me. So I have 3 Jingo now, and I really want to use it to kill someone. But is it going to be possible? My damage is sort of like semi-low because I have Lincoln Sphere. Lincoln Sphere doesn't give that much. It's not bad, 15 tributes and 15 damage. It's actually pretty decent, but still. There are heavier damage items like Desolator, for an example. Which also means I can't get solo kills as much, which is fine, because again, they're kind of going together a lot, like 2-3. If you look compared to us, and that's kind of what I was saying, as a team, they played 10 times better than we did. They really did. The fact that we won this is like kind of amazing now that I look back on it. They were just constantly like moving together and being way more, you know, because like solo, 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 he's dead, and they're sort of solo. They're going together, but they're still 2 supports. And Viper's there, of course. And that happens a lot this game, especially from Void. He tends to just solo completely. So I decide to go on him here. I'm not going to get a kill. It's just not happening. And do I ult? I believe I do. Which is sad, because he should have ulted really quickly, and that wouldn't have happened. Not that it would have mattered, because I still would have killed him. But it means Death Prophet can't go in here. because she'll die, and she does, which is a mistake. I don't think she dies though, because like I don't have bash yet. If that had I had bash, another bash would have been a kill. So they chase here. Follow me, I'm here. And I'm like, nah, guys, please be careful. And we killed her with Boundless Strike there. Oh yeah, by the by, I guess I should quickly go over this. And Michael actually gets, Michael, she's just calling Void. Michael actually gets two kills, which makes me happy, because this is like, it's good when he does good in this game. I also decide up to go for Shadow Blade, just so I can get better engagements off. It goes alright. Again, I die one more time. It's actually because of Shadow Blade I get it on her, but you'll see. Anyway, I really want to go over how I skill with Monkey King. I usually get 10 attack speed or 5 armor, both are good, but 10 attack speed is technically better. Then I get 275 health, mainly because you don't need 20 movement speed. It's alright, but I prefer the health just to stay stronger. 15 strength and 40 damage, both are really good. I like building more tanky, but 40 damage is also strictly better. And last one is always pretty much going to be Boundless Strike crit. Magic resist is nice, but it's just not as good as the crit. It just means you can dish out so much more damage. So, I don't see why you wouldn't do it. And again, in any game that goes late game with Monkey King, you will of course get, you know, Boundless Strike crit plus. So now I have it. And I can't remember when it is I die, but it goes kind of ugh following that. And she's gonna die here to a glimpse, I believe? Not even. Not sure if he saw me. I would need to see it for his predictions, but it's fine. He goes back, and I really want to kill him, as you can tell. I decide against it, even though he doesn't have that much, because, again, if Legion is here, she might potentially kill me. I can see her here, so I'm just talking BS, but still, in case they can somehow follow up on me, I still want to play careful. I don't want to go too far, you know. So I believe it's here, because I remember Void is farming here, and I basically go like, okay, Elsie's here. Excuse me, boy, sorry. I go like, okay, voice, let's kill. And I should Shadowblade right here, as I do. And I look for Legion. Now, they are all down here, in all fairness. But still, I do tell him I'm going to go for Legion. I don't remember if I get my ulti off. I don't think I do. So I go for Legion here, and I kind of expect his follow-up. But he just completely bails out. And he is pretty much out of there. Why does this piss me off so much? It pisses me off because he could literally jump in and kill this guy quickly. Even without, like, you know, look at how long I'm alive here. He bails out completely. I'm well aware he didn't have ultimate. It's kind of like, I kind of understand his move, but at the same time, he needed to play around me. And he could easily have killed up this raptor. He just kind of panicked as soon as he got ultied, which was sad. So that was really, really bad. I also do think he proceeds to die following this. It was kind of like, eh, because it was a bad movement by me as well. But I had expected his follow-up. And if he had, he would definitely have killed one or two, I'm pretty sure. He could have killed and then he could have ulted for more. He was fairly tanky and they used everything on me, so, you know. He ults in here. Again, not very good, because he's going to end up dying. And there you have it. So, if he was going to do that, he might as well have gone in with me, because he would have gotten better results there. My entire team goes in now and dies. So this is where like I'm like, shit, there's a good chance we actually lose this, isn't there? So it's after this engagement where I'm like, okay, I'm done playing around Void after that mistake. Because he clearly does not, either he doesn't listen or he doesn't trust me. And I'm like, alright, that's fair. I mean, I don't understand why, because I'm, if you look at the score, we're doing relatively well, 15-3-10. But I respect it, because I have to. If I don't, I will just play around him, and that's a bad thing. So I decide it's okay. It's maybe a good idea not to play around him, but play more around the three other people, and I do that now. I also tell them, okay, maybe be careful around Void and start to farm more. And yeah, that's kind of going to be our game plan now. I basically switch up, so I play more defensively at this point. Because I'm afraid of Void kind of messing it up. So they get a lot of damage in here, which is annoying. And I come up. And do I do a bad Wukong ultimate? I think I do. Yeah, I do. Again, should have jumped. I actually do a fair few of bad ultimates where I could have done better. Which is, like Monkey King says, I kind of remedy myself later in the game. But I've done like two or three Wukong commands, or ultimates, where I'm like, it doesn't really matter that much because it's not like an Enigma ultimate that takes forever. But still, it is sad that I'm not getting that free kill, you know. And a mistake is a mistake, no matter how we look at it. I see him and I'm like, yes. And he glimpses me and it's gonna go, and he knows he's dead. He knows he's dead at this point. Lifesteal? Or killsteal? I don't mind. It's late game anyway. But yeah, you can see I'm gonna basically end up farming a lot more now, because I'm afraid. So basically, I will only like come in when there's a need to at this point in the game. Like, if Void is beside me and he gets jumped, I will go in, for an example. But notice how I'm not actively trying to look for kills anymore, and I'm just like gonna try to sit and farm. Reason for this is just because I'm terrified. I don't want to lose the game now. So I'd rather play defensively, because I do believe we can beat these guys late game. And I believe my exact words would like, okay guys, just sit and farm, hopefully, like, let Void get a lot of items so he can't die. Same for me too, for that matter. So I go in here, but that's not really to kill her, it's just to like Shadowblade works in conjunction with Q, and you'll see here. It's just to get this, really. It's not to gank at all. So Shadowblade is like an okay item, but like, ugh. He goes in here. Michael. I'm gonna do this, like, sometimes the replays start jagging a little bit. When you jump around too much, it's annoying. Wow. Right, there we go. So, we're back here. Damn, I wonder how long this one is. Guess we'll find out. It's fine. I needed a replay analysis anyway. Kyunalysis for Monkey King. Right, okay, that was... I can't remember every engagement because this game was actually fairly long. We're not too far from over though. We're on the home stretch. So I see them going on Void. I'm like, okay, super, because that's just kind of what I've expected. Because he kind of played around, not around the team. I was like, okay, fair. Because if they're going to use everything on him, that's better than them using everything on me, because I will do more than Void. I guarantee you. If I get Wukong's command off, I'll do 10 times more than Void than he will with one ultimate. Because his ultimate needs follow-up, mine doesn't. So this is what happens. I'm like, okay, they're gonna go on him now, and I do Wukong's command. Well, first I stun her, so she doesn't get as much off, and I just do Wukong's command. And this is somewhat how it looks. And I just decide to go in, because why not? Well, I don't know why I go to the side here. I guess I'm a bit afraid anyway. I'll look at how this goes. I'm just gonna keep it in slow motion for your sake. Look at how much damage I produce. Isn't this hero beautiful? It's actually sad I Boundless Struck so quickly. If I had Boundless Struck there, I would have killed all of them. But I managed to kill like 3 people here alone. He sends someone back, I believe it's on dying, and he will die as well. So we end up killing 4 people. All because Void died. No jokes. Undying? What plane? He did that good. So I tell them, I believe we push mid or something. But I could, technically, if I had Boundless Strike there, we could have killed all 5 of them. Of course, like, this is under the circumstance that, you know, LC would have died as well without my Boundless Strike. Again, just saying, if we had it. So I go here, I Q. I usually Shadowblade first just to get the extra damage off. Does so much damage. And we just go in. And I basically tell them, just go, just go, just go. And at this point, Crystal Maiden gets very mad with me, I believe. So I tell them we should just go Roshan, and she's like, no, no, push, 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 and I'm like, there's no need to push, because they're very, like, they're out relatively soon. So I don't see why we would be pushing, because LC and Disruptor is very scary. I believe this is here at least, let me see if it is. If I go Roshan, this is what I said it was. I think I told them to Rosh. Yeah, I did. We're heading straight for Rosh. And Chris Maiden got really mad with me, because she was like, of course you could push and win! It's like, no, we really couldn't. We really, really, really couldn't. To be fair, they didn't have their ultimates, but I still don't want to fight into this too much. They don't have Death Prophet, but outside of that, I don't see why we wouldn't go Roshan. It's the safer play. And as I've already said, I don't really trust Void and he's dead, so it's still 4v5 when they come. And I don't want to do that. But they scout, we do Rosh, and that's fine, because I tell the team, just go Rosh, it's fine. And we're just going to fight here, and that's precisely what we mean to do. And because of this ward here, which is really good, by the way, it's scout. I scout Weaver and them porting in. I'm like, okay, so I'm going to jump up here. Which I often do. And we're gonna sit and wait here. And I basically wait on them going in. And I told my team, just fight, just fight. If they're willing to come in, that's fine. And they overextend by going in here, which is kind of silly. They could have just stood here and nothing would have come of it. But I'm gonna keep this in flow because it's a big team fight incoming. But I can see if she wants to come in, which was weird. And I wait just a bit because I want them to a bit closer. And I see he does Tombstone, so I know I have to go in now. So I do my ultimate here. Not perfect, but I'm gonna place it here. And big area denial. So at this point, they're already fighting 4v5. And they can't really fight into my ultimate, of course. I believe Void jumps in and alts. He really should. Jump in on alt. Void jump in and alt. Okay, he does not do that. I mean, it's a decent ultimate. He could have caught three people if he'd been a bit quicker. He could also have had them in Wukong's command, but whatever. Again, as I said, I didn't really super trust him this game. But we still get a kill here. We don't get Necro, sadly. I follow Necro here. Can't remember. I do get him, because Monkey King is pretty balanced. And then we finish LC off here. Disruptor comes too. We kill him as well, I think. Of course I kill him. Meme. So now I'm like, okay, go back to Roche. Because, like, again, why wouldn't we? Or is this here where... this is here where Crystal Mangan's really mad. She's like, oh, push! Push! It's like, the lane is here, dude. By the time we get up there... It wasn't before. It was actually here. Because she got really mad because she wasn't alive, too. But I'm like, by the time we get up here, they're back. Why wouldn't we not go back and take an easy free Roche and give it to me? Because once I have Aegis, I can play Super Baller. But yeah, I don't know what it is. Usually people in lower MMRs tend to be more unagreeable with you. I don't know what it is. It's just a theme, I guess. Not sure why I'm not taking those. And why I'm not skilling here is beyond me. I believe I will in a second. There you go. So I go back here and I have Aegis. So now with Aegis, and because I didn't, you know, try to do something here, because like even buybacks, what the fuck, not necessary here now. I have Aegis and I'm gonna buy Skull Basher. So now my ultimate becomes terrifying. And the next item and last item of the game is gonna be a, two items. It's gonna be an Abyssal Blade and a Silver Edge, of course. Again, she goes dying. And I believe this is where I told them, okay, please go as five, and they still didn't do it. And yeah, that was kind of it. Of course, like, I'm scouting a bit ahead, but that's because I'm Shadowblade and I have Aegis. So now I can play like this without, like, mining it too much. So I'm gonna probably Q here. No? Yes? No? No? Okay. So there's gonna be an engagement here, if memory serves. Yep, they're gonna go in here. And I poured out? I should have stayed then. It's actually a misplay by me, but I was porting already. I could have stayed and literally just ulted and the enemy would have died here. Can't remember if this goes well without me, actually. So I'm gonna look here. Because I remember moving up here so I could deal with Weaver split pushing. That's actually why I was porting. They kill one guy. Void keeps going here. I know Elsie is here. Ghost Woman comes in here. They get two kills, so that's already a decent trade, really. But Void will probably die from this. Does he have Aghanims yet? Yeah, he does. Pretty sweet. But still, they both trade. And to be fair, I could have been down there, and honestly, it would have been better. But I told them, like, 3 or 5 seconds, well, more than that, 10 seconds in advance, I was planning on porting, because I saw Weavers by pushing. But in all fairness, if I had been down there, Wukong's command could have killed all of them, easily, because I don't think they knew I was there in the trees. And it would have just been this tower. It wouldn't have been all that bad. I could have just Wukong commanded and killed them all and then ported after that. But Vita let live, whatever you want to say. I was hoping they were going to back too. Again, the communication part being a bit ich. Again, see, they don't have buyback, which scares me to bits. I just bought close to like not having buyback. I tried to keep buyback by like 30 minutes and forward in this game though. After that one fuck up with Void, I was like, okay, I need to say buyback now because that's liable to happen again. And if it does, I need to not randomly lose a game because of that kind of decision from me. So yeah, that's why I'm so keen on trying to like get money. We're gonna wait here a bit. And you can tell here, this is like where I asked for them to buy smoke. He didn't do so voluntarily. I just said, can we smoke? And I'm like, okay, gather up for smoke. Void ports in here and doesn't want to play with us, of course. He doesn't give a shit what I say, basically. And I'm just like, okay, just port without Void. It's fine. Or just smoke without Void is fine. And that's pretty much what we do. He didn't care. Excuse me. Again, it can be really hard to play with these kind of players because it's hard to play around him. And sure enough, see what happens because he doesn't port with us. But this makes a perfect opportunity for us to go in and do exactly this, which is awesome. So his death is only to our advantage again. So if I do have to give Void some kind of credit, it is that he was an incredibly good scapegoat this game. He did do that very well. And just look at how my ultimate decimates them. It's so good. And again, he's dead for 100 seconds. And I believe I asked him, can we follow up? Follow up, because I do have Aegis. There's no reason for us not to go forward, really. And here we are. And I really want to get him, but he blinked. And I follow him up. And I'm going to wait for that to go out, because if I hit him now, and he blinks, I remember not getting him, sadly. I couldn't spring there, basically, which was why. I could have bombed the struck without getting the damage. It would have actually stopped him. Sort of a misplay, actually. It's fine. I asked him to port regardless. To push regardless. Because, again, at this point, I'm, like, not even playing around Void being a player. Oh, shit, sorry. Jesus, let's just rewind time for a second. Also, sorry for my coughing. Wintertime in Denmark is kind of harsh on my throat. So I go in here, which is actually kind of sad that Necro was there as well. Both of them die. And again, I tank this tower intentionally just to die, because I know Aegis is out very, very soon. But they keep healing me, and Aegis actually, like, is reclaimed here, which is sucky. Give me a second here. Sorry. Throat very scratchy. Right. So we just keep going here. And again, I don't mind dying. I'm actually looking for it. That's why I really want to kill Weaver, but he just goes all the way back here. So I know there's no way of getting that. I see Disrupt reporting here. I'm like, okay, let's just kill him because that's a forward port he doesn't need to do. And sure enough. And again, the more they do that, also it's really sad I'm attacking towers while that gets reclaimed, but it doesn't matter too much. But the more they randomly die, the better, because it, you know, it just kind of becomes easier. And just going to jump back again, because this is exactly what I'm talking about. This is a common bug, by the way. So basically what I'm going to do here is that I'm telling my team, just push. I'm going to do my ultimate, and I'm just going to deny space. And that's exactly what I do. Do you remember me talking about this the first 5 minutes, where how I sometimes say I use Wukong commands as like an area denial? This is the exact case. I have no reason to do this as far as an aggression. It's literally just a come at me bro kind of play, where if they decide to try and stop me from taking their melee and range rack, that's fair, but they're going to do it within my ultimate. And here's what happens. So you're going to see me do it now, because I want to get this. And it lasts forever, dude. It lasts 15 seconds. There's no way we are not going to get racks within 15 seconds, of course. And I tell my team, of course, come into my ultimate. Crystal Maiden does exactly not that, and she dies to LC, which is really tilting, but that's what happens. I still get racks, so her death doesn't really matter too much. You see, they don't dare to do anything about it, because there's not really a whole lot they can do. I mean, they're only two people, but still. And see how I keep myself in the ultimate. I don't want it to run out. But this is what I mean. Like, that's how I use it a lot. LC's gonna get away here. I believe either Viper or me misplaced. He does a good jump there. And I do a Boundless Strike. And I say, keep going. But Viper had already, like, kind of gone. So they're both gonna die now. Which is okay. I did tell them to bail. That's very sad. If he'd actually force staff before he did that, he would have been fine. Same with Undying. They both kept going for no reason. Undying should have just, like, bailed on Viper. This really shows how egotistic I can be, but it's worth it, because if I died, it would not like, it would have been kind of sad. But Undying could have ported out, because Viper kind of fucked himself off. And yeah, I'm basically the only one that survived that. Void wasn't even part of that, because Void wasn't part of most of it. He just kind of played his own game. He got carried big time in this game. So there's that. Now I have Jingo, so I'm ready for the next fight, and I'm going to go both Abyssal, and I believe it's going to be a Silver Edge. Not sure if I'm building it yet. I do believe I'm running up here to get the thing soon. Again, see how I go Shadowblade. Want to kill her. I don't quite make it up to her yet, which is sad. Should actually have done it this direction instead. That was kind of a misplay. Or waited for both of them. I had Jingo Strikes for it. So that's a misplay too. Killing it here. Lots of money. But I'm looking at my thing and I'm like, okay, I can buy Silver Edge now. Because I was like, 2,900, what do I want? I was thinking maybe Deso, but that's 3,500 and I won't have buyback. And I really want to have buyback, so I decided to go up here and get Silver Edge. And that's the final item I'm going to get this game, because the game is over now. When I get my ulti off, it's over. So, yet again, they really want to kill Void. What item did she just drop? That looked really weird. Right. So Void again, like again and again. I kind of harp on this player a bit too much, but it is true. He really did not want to play with the rest of the team. I tell them, go us 5 and we win the game. And I believe I even told them, Right, this is the perfect time to just push out bottom and win, because they don't have any lanes like particularly pushed yet. And this is what happens. Again, Void is picked off because of his positioning, but we end up winning because, well, we do good. I can't even say we do good follow-up, because we're just like counter-ganking them, really. You'll see what I mean. So Void gets... Sorry, it's CM. I believe it's Void later, though. It's CM that's getting picked off. Okay, fair enough. Harping on Void. Let's see here. So go into Shadowblade. Oh yeah, it's down here. Sorry, it's been a long night. So I go down here, and I really want to go on them. And I can see Void here, and I'm like, okay, perfect. They're all going to clump. Let's go Void, let's do it. And I go on her. And I do my ultimate. And that's pretty much it. Look at this. They are all getting bashed. And they're all in here. Like, there's no way they can even fight in here. It's completely dumb that Death Prophet goes in here. Like, there is no way they can actually fight here. And poor Disruptor too. He's just like, I immediately regret my decision. Let me try to bail out here. I should have kept going here. If I had been more ready, I could have killed him with Boundless Strike. Not that it matters, because it doesn't. We can just end the game. And again, I have buyback and stuff. And I believe I tell them just to push mid and like end the game. Or do I push bottom? I click end. Oh, no, we push bottom. That's right. Now, I do think it's Void dying, because I actually thought it was here, but I do think it's him dying here. We'll find out, though. At this point, I'm 21-3-22, so that's pretty good. Again, I have no idea how quick this one is, like how long this one is. I imagine it's like 30 to 40 minutes. It's fine. The Kyunalysis is not meant to be like a low... Like, it's meant to be like, this is how, if I was paid for it, or if someone asked me nicely to do an analysis, this is exactly how it would be. It would be 30 plus minutes, and I got, of course, depending on game length. If a game is only 25 minutes, it's not doesn't take a whole lot to talk about. Right, so my decision here is very simple. I don't have Aegis, so I'm not in the front yet. But I know they're gonna, like, front them, and when they do, I'm just gonna ult. And Void has ultimate, so I'm also kind of waiting for him to do it. But I go in and do my ultimate, and my reasoning here is actually also relatively simple. It's just because, like, again, it's a denial thing. Like, now that I've done my ultimate, we have 15 seconds to get mega creeps, and yeah, they really can't fight in here. He does a random ultimate that completely misses everyone. I mean, again, great asset to the team, because like his is not air. Well, I suppose it's air denial, but still, not really. But like, look at how scary, like scared they are. Look at poor Disruptor. He's just getting completely mauled by my Monkey Kings here. The poor guy. Weaver as well, just getting completely whacked. And you can see the barracks are just going down. There's literally nothing they can do. LC is porting in my ultimate, and that's a big mistake to do. You're gonna see why really quickly, because he's gonna die from this. That is a very bad port in. There's no way he can ever sustain himself in Wukong's command, because it's simply just too strong. Actually just dies down already, but still. Again, the entire plan worked. I actually thought the Wukong command was like gonna last 3 more seconds. But the game is over here, so I'm just gonna speed it up. The game is practically over, because we're just gonna finish here. So I'm gonna speed up. And that's kind of it. So, some stuff is happening. I do my ultimate, and that's pretty much the game. So, that was the read of Monkey King, and yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. I'm gonna show you, I tipped my Undying, because he played really well. He was the only guy that didn't make me angry that game. Most people sort of listened to me, but not really. But Undying was the one that had, like, I had his loyalty, and he just played well. He healed me, he made sure I won my lane. He supported me, and he didn't complain with anything I did. So he deserved a tip. I will tip / commend people that play like that, because if supports or mids or whatever are just nice and they play well around you, I will always commend them pretty much, because I think it's worth it to commend people that deserve it. But yeah, that's the game. I'm going to press continue here, and you're going to see the end score of the screen. So this is the end score, 60-40. From left to right, Undying at 12-10-27, Void at 8-9-25. Not exactly a good score. His score was actually pretty decent, mid-game, sort of like early mid-game. And then it just became meh because he made so many mistakes. 5-12 19 on Crystal Maiden, 22-3-25 on Monkey King. Again, excuse me. This is why I keep saying even if Monkey King is nerfed, I still feel like he's incredibly powerful. I went from being an offlaner to our hard carry. If I had not been doing this well, we would have lost this game for sure. Because Void was not going to carry that, let's be honest with ourselves. Viper, doing okay. 13, 6, 12, he died a little bit too much, but still, he did okay. He was a fine soft carry for the team. So it was a pretty good game. Again, Undying is the one I commended, because he... Tapu, 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 tapu. Never mind his score, it was his personality, it was the way he played, the way he supported me, the fact that he didn't complain and stuff. So yeah, that's the read on the Monkey King. I'm gonna show you one more thing before I end this game, because in case you think this is a fluke, it's not. I just wanted to like prove my Monkey King score. So I played Monkey King like 19 games now, I think. Let's find him here, and just wanted to show it to you. So these are my stats. I'm sitting comfortably at 84.2% win. It's 19 games with 3 losses and 16 wins. One of the losses are a party game, and I remember like one where I had a feeder, like intentional feeding, and then one I feel like I lost legit. So in my mind, that's 16-1, but still 16-3 and 84% win rate. I can't really complain about that. I will say though that all of these games here are before he was nerfed, and these two games are after he was nerfed. I've only had two games with the nerf Monkey King, but I'm still doing fairly well with him, as you can tell. So yeah, this is my Monkey King score. This was my replay analysis, my Kyunalysis of my Monkey King replay, and I hope it's useful. It's kind of long, but yeah, if you want to learn Monkey King, can highly suggest you do. He's gonna get nerfed. He's gonna get nerfed. I hate to break it to you guys, but he's gonna get nerfed. He has to. He's too strong still. But enjoy him while you can, and he's really, really fun, so I can recommend it. And even honestly, if he gets nerfed, there's a good chance he's still gonna remain viable because his toolkit is just so strong. But this has been Kyubashi. Thank you for watching this video. I hope it's useful, and I hope you are gonna play Monkey King and have a good time with him because he is a lot of fun, and there is some decent entry level. A lot of people are apparently losing with him, which is weird to me. But he's very, very strong. So yeah, practice, practice, practice. Malpractice makes perfect. But yeah, thank you for watching. See you guys soon. Like what you saw, you can follow my YouTube channel or you can check me out on Twitch TV, FabKyubashi. Have a good one. Stay safe, stay happy, and do your best out there, people.